First John chapter number 3, and we've been talking about this business of really family likeness, right? I mean, you're in the family of God. There's a family likeness. There is, as the children of God, the one who is coming. Remember, we behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons or the children of God. Wonderful truth that is. It's just like if we would just consider that great love, that we are not just forgiven sinners, we're sons in the family, right? So understand that. We're not just forgiven sinners, we're actually the sons of God, right? Right now. And it goes on to say, we know we are right now the sons of God. Those who are saved, you are right now a son of God. And yet we do not yet, right? Though we don't look like it, we don't look like sons of God in the world's mind. The world doesn't know us, but we don't look like we are sons of God. Can't see it with the natural eye, right? But the Bible says, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet. There is the future aspect of everything. We are right now the sons of God, and there is a not yet aspect of what we shall be. We're right now the sons of God, and it does not yet appear. It's not yet manifested. It's not yet clearly seen. Right? That's what it's talking about here. What we shall be. Look at me, I'm not much. But I might say, not yet. Holy Spirit of God lives in me right now. I am a child of God. I'm adopted. But remember what I said about adoption. Adoption doesn't speak simply of me coming into the family of God. Adoption has a future aspect of where I will get everything that is mine as a child of God. We are waiting for that, the Bible says in Romans chapter number 8, the manifestation of the sons of God, the appearing when we get all that we have. The Holy Spirit of God right now is called the earnest of the Spirit. He serves as like a down payment, as earnest money of all that will be ours. When the Holy Spirit of God comes into a person's life when they are saved, and that's what happens when you're saved, God moves in, Holy Spirit of God comes in, you receive Christ, you receive life because he is that life. The Holy Spirit of God comes in. And the Bible says we are blessed by the Holy Spirit with all things that pertain unto life and godliness. We've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly place. So the Holy Spirit of God gives me everything I need to live in this world right now. But the Holy Spirit of God is a guarantee, a down payment, like an earnest, proof positive, that I will get everything. There is more to come. Though I have everything I need to live in this world right now, he hadn't given me everything that's mine. For instance, the Holy Spirit lives in me right now, but I don't have my new body. There is still the not yet aspect of that. There is a day when I will have a glorified body. Even though right now I'm a child of God, you can't tell. Right? Not just by looking at me. The world doesn't know us. The world doesn't know how to compare spiritual with spiritual. Right? Natural men don't receive the things of the Spirit of God. So the world doesn't know us, right? Now, look at verse number 2. Again, I want you to understand there is the right now aspect of being a child of God. You are right now. But then there is the not yet aspect. Things that are not manifested, things that we don't have right now. What we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And remember, we talked about what we will ultimately be. We have been saved from the penalty of sin, the Spirit of God. We are being saved from his power. One day we will be saved from his possibility. You follow that? When I will not any longer be able to sin, I will receive a glorified body. Ultimately. That's a, when the Lord Jesus Christ comes, the Bible talked about this hope. That's our blessed hope. Right? The Bible calls that our blessed hope when Jesus Christ comes. And the Bible says, for those who are alive when Jesus Christ comes, we shall be what? 1 Corinthians 15. What? We shall be changed. We shall be changed. And that's what the Bible says in Philippians 3, that our vile bodies, these old corrupt bodies, will be made like unto his glorious body. See? So I love this because we are right now the children of God. Everything that we shall be does not yet appear. But what the rest of the chapter goes on to talk about, really, if you look at it and understand it, is that there are some evidences, however, for the children of God who are right now the children of God. If you are right now, are y'all with me this morning? Y'all kind of like looking glazed over, right? But if you are right now a child of God, it is not yet apparent what we're going to be. But what about right now over to not yet? What about that period? That's where we are right now. Does that make sense? And my point is that there are some evidences of being a child of God right here. Even though it does not yet appear what we shall be, we are now the sons of God. And between now to not yet, there ought to be evidences that we are, in fact, the children of God. And that's what the chapter talks about, right? And it talks about basically these two principles. One is a principle of righteousness and the other is a principle of lawlessness. You see, righteousness is proof positive that you're a child of God. Look at what it says, verse number 3. Every man that has this hope, that is that hope of Jesus' coming, right? Not sitting around with our fingers crossed hoping he'll come. That's not the idea, right? So now our hope is not a verb. We're not hoping to have. But we are having a hope, right? It's steadfast. It's sure. It's what we're looking forward to. It is that thing that is promised. That's the hope. Not this. Not this. Not what we're hoping to have. No. We have a hope. And we have this hope. We have it. It's an anchor to our souls. We have this hope. And everyone that has this hope, the Bible says, purifies himself as the one who is coming, the one who is appearing is pure. That is, it goes back to what the Bible talks about in verse number 28 of the previous chapter, about when he comes, we might not be what? Ashamed. We don't have to shrink back in shame because he's coming and he is pure. And so because he is pure, I have this hope. I'm looking for him to come. I'm looking for me to be manifested as a child of God. If I really have this hope, I will be right now purifying myself because the one who is coming is pure. We talked a little bit about this whole idea of purifying ourselves. I cannot simply purify myself by myself. It's a work of God. But God does the what? Cleaning, and I do the what? Letting. Peter, if I do not wash your feet, you can't have fellowship with me. So Peter, he didn't say, Peter, if you don't wash your feet, it's God who does the cleansing. But Peter, you got to do the surrendering. You got to do the confessing. Goes back to chapter number 1. We confess our sins. He is faithful and just to do what? Forgive us and to what? Cleanse us. So that purifying of ourselves is a confessing of our sins, a consciousness of walking in a dirty world in a way that honors God. Even now. Amen. Right now. That's a consciousness in our hearts and in our minds. Because we believe that the Lord, who is pure, is coming. The implications of that is that I am to live pure because the one who is coming is pure. So every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin, the old King James says, transgresses the law. The idea is not just a committing of sin. The idea is how this is written in the Greek, in the present tense, is that the one who is living and practicing and committing sin. A person who is living and practicing sin as a way of life. He's not talking about a person who might sin. He's talking about a person who is living in sin. Might a Christian sin? You better believe it. If you didn't, that would mean you're perfect. You don't have a sinful nature. You do have that. If it means if I ever sin that I'm not a child of God, then who qualifies? None of us qualify. It can't mean that if I sin, I'm not a child of God, because John in chapter number 1 himself said, if I say I don't have sin, I'm deceiving myself. The idea is that Christians, while we are not sinless, Christians do sin less. Right? It's not that a sheep can't fall in the mud, but a sheep doesn't live in the mud. Not a sheep's nature. And so the idea is, whoever is practicing sin as a way of life is transgressing the law. For sin is the transgression of law. So here's what he's talking about now. He's talking about this lawless living. The antinomian, the person who is living in sin without regard to God at all, without regard to the one who is coming. This lawless kind of living, no compunction of soul, no conviction of soul, abandoned to sin as a principle. That's the person who is practicing sin. That person is living a lawless life. So he's talking about lawlessness as a principle. And he's saying that person who does that is living a lawless life. Whoever abideth in him, by the way, in God, does not practice sin. Does not practice sin as a way of life. Whoever sinneth has not seen him, neither know him. Whoever is practicing sin as a way of life. Okay, so that's whether you're having an affair or whether you're operating an illegal business. Right? No compunction, no conviction, just day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, no problem. I made a decision long ago. Now, I'm just telling you, this is a warning passage. You know what you do with the warning passage? You be warned. He's saying this is a test. Are you living in lawlessness or are you living in righteousness? This is not to give you a neurosis. This is not to, you know, a passage like this is calling us to do some thinking, to do some introspection, Not that anything in my life merits salvation, but I need to find out, am I trusting Jesus? Have I trusted Jesus? Right? There's nothing wrong with examining that. Fact is right. Better do that than to be deceived and whistle your way into damnation. Happy as you can be. This is a warning passage, and God gives us enough warning in the scripture to keep us humble. He gives us enough promises in the passage to keep us hopeful. But there is that tension where I have to take the word of God, look into the word of God, and be warned so as not to be deceived. Your heart is deceitful. Your very heart is deceitful and a lie to you. So I hope you're not believing a lie, because here's what he says. Whoever is abiding in him, that's the whole principle over in chapter number 2. Everything is remain, remain, abide, remain, abide, abide, remain. Same word, meno. And then he says, whoever abideth in him does not practice sin as a way of life. Sinneth not. That's what it says, verse number 6. Whoever is practicing sin as a way of life hath not seen him, neither know him. Now, this is not a preacher making something up. I'm reading the Bible. Then he says this, little children, God's darlings, let no man deceive you. John is writing like to God's little children. It's like, let no man deceive you. We all little children, and we can all be deceived, all be tricked. Don't let anybody fool you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. You see this? The principle of a child of God is righteousness, not lawlessness. That's what he's getting across. And he says, don't kid yourself. You follow what I'm saying? Don't let anybody kid you. Do you see how simple that is right there? That's what he's teaching. A person who is living in lawlessness has not seen God. They're just not saved. And those who are living in righteousness, these are the ones that are the children of God. And don't be deceived. He that is, watch, the King James says, he that committeth sin, that is practicing sin as a way of life, that word of committing sin, that's the principle. That's what he's getting across. Not a person who, I looked at something I shouldn't have looked at. I did what I shouldn't have done. Who's not guilty of that? I'm not giving permission now. I'm just saying, who's not guilty of that? You know you've sinned. And if you say you hadn't sinned, John says you're a liar. So a Christian may sin. You know that. But the idea in my life where, you know, there is a continual practice of sin as if with impunity. No conviction, no burden, no compunction of soul. Right? Have you gotten to where you can't sin anymore? No. But if we're Christians and walking with the Lord, you got to where you can't what? Enjoy it like you used to. Who is practicing sin is of the devil. This is not me talking. This is what God says right here. So this is a warning passage. For the devil sinned from the beginning. And for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. In other words, listen, the one who is coming again, the one that we are looking for that is coming, he is what? Pure, right? Now watch this. The Bible says clearly that there is no sin in him. Let me read. He that committed sin is of the devil, for the devil sins from the beginning. For this is the purpose of the Son of God, was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Who is born of God does not continue to practice sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. In this is manifested, in this the children of God are manifested. That is, there are evidence, right? Not what we shall be, but right now there are evidences in the life of a believer, and the children of the devil are manifested. Children of righteousness, the children of God, they walk under the principle of righteousness. The children of the devil walks under the principle of lawlessness. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. So now watch. The God who is coming is pure, right? When he comes, and by the way, that's our great hope, he's coming, he's pure. Right now we're the sons of God because we know the one who is coming is pure. We ought to be purifying ourselves. That's the idea. We ought to be careful about how we walk. We ought to care. We ought to be careful, right? The carefulness of our walk. We live in a dirty world. We ought to be confessing our sins. We ought to be keeping short accounts with God. That's what it means to walk in the light. If we say that we walk with him and walk in darkness, we what? Lie. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, the Bible says we have fellowship one with another. This is how it works. So he's coming. I'm to be walking in the light in this world, not in lawlessness, but in righteousness. Why? Because the one who is coming is pure. If I walk in lawlessness, I'm walking and really proving that I'm of the devil. And the one who is coming again came the first time to destroy the works of the devil. Here's what the implications are. How can we, as the children of God, have a hope in a God who comes in purity, who came the first time to destroy the works of the devil? How can then we be walking in fellowship with the devil, expecting him to come? It's incongruent. The one who's coming again came the first time, was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. How then are we as the children of God content to walk in the works of the devil? To walk in lawlessness. That's the implication of the passage. Okay? These guys can't handle hard preaching. Look at them leaving. Hey, guys. Okay. Yeah, I know you get my point. Right. So I'm going with those guys here in just a minute. So, but listen to this. Here's the thing I want you to get. Listen to what it says here. In verse number 7, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested or appeared, that is the first time. We know he shall appear, but he has already appeared, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever is born of God doth not practice sin. For his, that is God's seed, remains in him. You know what a seed is? A seed is something that is sown. You know what that means? That God has sown something in the child of God. So what is that seed? It's two ideas here, two thoughts, and I believe both of them are true, not one over the other. Is that seed is the word of God. You know, the Bible says that we were born not of corruptible seed, right? But by the word of God, the good seed of God's word. The word of God is sown in us. Of his own will begot he us. It's like a conception took place by the word of God, is what James says. You know what the word, by the way, you know the Greek word for seed? Sperm. Sperma. Right? So Paul has got an analogy here that God has implanted me with the Word of God. That's the seed that remains. So what is that seed? His seed remains in him, the Word of God. Or I might say, and the Spirit of God. Because when we were saved, the Spirit of God was sown into us. Right? The Bible calls him the witness over in chapter number 5. Chapter number 5, verse number 6. This is he that came by the water, talking about Jesus, came by the water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by the water and the blood. And it is the Spirit that bears witness because the Spirit is truth. So now watch, the Spirit of God is in us. He that has Jesus has the witness in himself, and the Spirit of God is that witness. Look at verse number 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. Now, who is the witness? Verse number 6 says it's the Spirit of God. I can't enlarge upon this, but listen. We have the seed in us as the children of God, the Word of God, the Spirit of God, and this precludes the child of God living in habitual sin. That's what the point is. Hey, listen, guys. Let's pray and we'll dismiss this morning. Father, we're thankful for the truth of your word, and while we read other books, this is the only book that reads us. The truth of your word will search us out. And so, Lord, we read here right in your word what you say. It's a warning to all of us so as to keep us from walking in deception. And we're thankful for your word. Thank you for the witness of your Spirit for those who are saved, that your Spirit bears witness in our lives with our spirits that we are in fact the sons of God. And though it doth not yet appear what we shall be, we know, Father, that we are right now your sons. And that the evidences of all of those things is that there is the principle of righteousness in our lives. Help us to embrace it and live by it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.